Okay, so welcome everyone to this very interesting science cafe on sleep. And we are very pleased to have here Dr. Nils Sandman from the Department of Psychology of the University of Turku. And Nils will talk about, of course, sleep, why and how. And differently, or a little bit differently from the other science cafes, he's very happy to take questions during his talk also. So please interrupt him anytime. But we will also have the question and answer session after the science cafe. But we would like to have also some dialogue during the science cafe.
Yes.
Okay. So, Nils.
Thank you. So, welcome everyone. And as I mentioned, I have a lot of topics, and after every topic you can ask questions, because there are these subtopics about sleep. And we have a lot of stuff, so let's get started, so we'll not run out of time. So to start things off, what is sleep and what it is not? And sleep is this global state of the brain and the body. So it is not just something that happens in your brain. And sleep is also not something, it is not a state of consciousness. It is accompanied by altered state of consciousness. And it is completely different thing from dreaming. So maybe we will talk about dreaming later at some point, but now we are talking about this state of the mind and the body, and not the contents of the mind during that sleeping. Okay. And of course, what is important about sleep is that during sleep, the animal is inactive, it doesn't really do anything, and it is also disconnected from the environment. So it doesn't get sensory input. When you are sleeping, you do not know anything what happens around you. We can measure many things during sleep. And we can see that there are these certain patterns of brain electrical activity that always occur during the sleep. But there is also some more stuff going on in the body. For example, there are these certain patterns of thermoregulation. So your body temperature is sometimes falling, and then it's rising again, and it's falling. And actually, your body temperature is at its minimum during the whole day in the early hours of the morning, so around 2 o'clock, 3 o'clock. And this is when you wake up and feel cold if you are prone to doing that kind of stuff. Okay. There is also difference in muscle tone. So during non-REM sleep, you are actually paralyzed. So your muscles do not work, you cannot do anything with them. But no, during REM sleep, sorry. You should have said something. Yes. During non-REM sleep, you are just relaxed, but your muscles can work. And that is the phase of sleep that you can actually sleepwalk and do this kind of stuff. But during REM sleep, you are paralyzed. You cannot move at all. And you are completely relaxed. So if we measure the body or muscle activity during REM sleep, there is none. Okay. And sleep also affects hormonal activity. And maybe the most important one of these is that in children, the growth hormones are secreted during sleep. So the growth of the children actually happens while they are sleeping. And if they do not get enough sleep, that also negatively affects their growth. Okay. Of course, the hallmark of the sleep is that you can wake up, because there are also other states like comatose that have similar marks, but you cannot wake up. So during the sleep, you can, of course, if you get some strong enough sensory input, you will wake from the sleep. Okay. And the funny thing about sleep is that everything seems to sleep, at least everything that has been studied. So maybe the most primitive animal that has been studied about sleep is this boxed jellyfish over there. And as you can see, it does not have brains, because if it would have brains, you would see them, because the whole thing is transparent. It has just these neuronal bundles going around. And this jellyfish, what it does is it maintains certain depth in the water. And when it has done it enough, it gets tired and then it just floats around. And that is kind of the sleep of the jellyfish. And then it wakes up and maintains the depth again. If you prevent it from getting this rest, then it needs more on the next time. So it will get this sleep depth like many other animals. And when we go to these more complex organisms like the fruit fly, we can already see that what the fruit fly does during the day affects how much it needs to sleep. So if the fruit fly is alone in this tube, it sleeps less than if it's with another fruit fly, because the social life of the fruit fly tires the fly, and then it needs to sleep more. Then there are these strange things that are quite similar to us. So mammals, like the polar bear here, where actually polar bear is a bad example, but the brown bear is better, because they actually, we say that they sleep during the winter, but they are actually not sleeping, they are hibernating. And during hibernation, sometimes they have to rise up from this hibernating state to sleep, because they need something from the sleep that they are not getting from hibernation. And if they would just hibernate the whole winter, they would become unhealthy. They need to sometimes rise up and sleep and then hibernate again. And of course, then humans also sleep. And since we are day active animals, we usually sleep during the night. There are many animals that actually sleep during the day. So it is not about the changes in light are always important, but it is not so that you sleep when it's dark and are awake when it's light, but it depends on the species. Okay. And the evolutionary question about sleep is that when you are sleeping, you are not really doing anything to increase your reproductive success or doing anything other useful things. So why do all the animals spend their time sleeping while they could be doing something more useful? And the answer to this question is found in the observation that sleep is homeostatically regulated. And this means that you need certain amount of sleep, and if you do not get that amount of sleep, next time you sleep, you need more sleep. And everything that is homeostatically regulated is actually vital to your survival. So for example, thirst or hunger are other things that are homeostatically regulated. So if you don't get enough food, then you need more food. And if you don't get any food, you will die. And it seems that if you don't get any sleep, you will also die. But this has not been tested with humans, of course. It has been tested with rats, and rats die in a couple of weeks from total sleep deprivation. But there is this nasty disease called familiar fatal insomnia in humans that has one of its symptoms is that you will stop sleeping and then in a couple of months you will die. Okay. So you need certain amount, but how much do you need? And that actually depends on your age as well as your genetic makeup. So the sleep need is individual. Not everyone needs the same amount of sleep. And during your lifetime, you will need different amounts of sleep. So with the children of less than 3 years of age, they can sleep as much as they want. 15 hours is kind of this recommendation that is given, but it is not exact. Then little older children will still need over 10 hours of sleep. And usually it has been said that teenagers need 8 to 10 hours of sleep, and most of them don't get it. And for adults, so 7 to 9 hours is usually recommended. And the sleep need decreases throughout the life, but on healthy elderly, you should still need or have 7 to 8 hours of sleep. But many people in the advanced age have problems also maintaining this level of sleep, so they often wake up very early and can't get to sleep again. But every adult should aim for this 7 to 8 hours at least, and for some people this 9 to 10 hours might be good. But many people only sleep something like 6 hours. And some people might get by that, but usually it is not recommended, and probably there is no one who can get by with 4 hours without having some health problems. Okay. But actually, you should not sleep too much either. We do not know why, but these people who sleep from 10 to 12 hours per day also have health problems, and they have actually increased mortality. So very long sleepers are not feeling too well. And we do not know if that's because they sleep too much or do they sleep too much because they have other health problems. But there are these lower and upper limits for these recommendations. Okay. Yes. No, not really, actually. In Western societies these days we like to sleep one consolidated period, but there are also cultures where you sleep two sleeps, for example, 3 plus 4 hours, and many people nap, and that is okay, so you can sum them up. So if you don't get enough sleep during the night, you can sleep during the day. Okay.
Ask one more question.
Yes.
I remember reading somewhere that the sleep depth.
Reading from somewhere that the sleep depth is kind of a myth. So if you for 5 days only sleep 4 or 5 hours of sleep, then the fifth night you don't have to sleep more than you would normally have to sleep over the 7 to 9 hours.
Yes, it is not a myth. You do not have to pay all of it, but you have to pay some of it. So when you have slept, for example, 5 hours, or 4 hours, the next night you will not sleep all of the lost sleep. So you are not sleeping 4 hours more, but you are sleeping a couple of hours more. And your sleep will be more efficient. So you will have more of this non-REM sleep and less REM sleep. So something that is very important in non-REM sleep, and we do not really know what, is getting repaid. And if you have accumulated kind of tens of hours of sleep that you cannot pay back, of course, by sleeping two days in a row, but you will sleep more. So it is not a myth, but you do not pay all of your sleep debt.
Okay.
Yes. And if you have slept as much as you need to, you will get these positive effects going on. So your attention and memory work better, and your learning ability is better. Your metacognition is also better, so you are making better decisions, and it's easier for you to understand what is a good decision. And on the other hand, if you have not slept enough, you will probably make worse decisions. And this is kind of ironic, because metacognition is this monitoring of your own cognition. And that means also that if you have impaired metacognition, you do not know when you are making bad decisions. So people who have been sleep deprived in the laboratory, and they are taking this test that tests some decision making skills, they are making worse decisions, but they are more sure that they are good. And this is problematic, because we have this culture, for example, that if some very important political decision needs to be made, they will stay up the whole night before in the morning they think that now they have the solution. And that is the impaired metacognition. It is not a better decision. Yes. Okay. And this is why the Finnish saying that you should, it is not Finnish saying, it is a global saying that you should sleep on it, actually makes sense, because in the morning you can make better decisions than if you are tired. Also, mood and emotional regulation. So if you have slept well, it is easier for you to regulate your emotions and be on the better mood. And if something bad happens, you can deal with it easier. But if you have not slept again, then you are more, you get irritated much more easily, and everything kind of gets on your nerves. And also, on the long term, this long sleep deprivation can lead to depression. So sleep is important for the mood. And for the body part of the sleep, immune system functions better if you get enough sleep. And there has been these nice experiments that people have been sleep deprived, and then they have been brought into this room with one person who has a flu, and those person who did not have enough sleep, they had a higher percentage of getting that flu than those that had enough sleep. So in very real sense, if you do not sleep enough, you will get more of these infections. And also, if you already are ill, you should sleep a lot, and probably more than usual, because it boosts your immune system. Okay. And I also already mentioned that children are growing when they sleep, but also if you are exercising yourself as an adult, most of the development of muscles actually happens while you sleep. So you need to rest after you have exercised, or otherwise you will not get all the benefits. And metabolism works better when you sleep enough, and if you do not sleep enough, you will crave for these carbohydrates and fats, so unhealthy food. And if you are having sleep deprived, if you are sleep deprived for a long time, you have a risk of gaining weight. Okay. Yes. But this is the first place where I think that you have a lot of questions, because we are in Finland. And everyone likes coffee. And coffee is, well, what happens in coffee is that there is, of course, caffeine in the coffee. But many people do not know what caffeine actually does. It does not give you more energy. The way the homeostatic control of the sleep works, or one of the ways, is that while you are awake, your cellular activity produces this chemical called adenosine. And your brain keeps tab on the level of the adenosine. So when adenosine level rises, there are these receptors in your brain that see that, okay, there are a lot of adenosine going on. And that probably means that we have been awake for a long time and we should sleep. And then you become tired. But what caffeine is a technical term, is adenosine receptor antagonist. And that means that this caffeine goes to the same place where the adenosine is supposed to go, and it blocks these receptors. And then your brain doesn't know what is the level of adenosine actually going on. And that means that even if you are a tired person, you have been awake for a long time, your brain doesn't know that. It doesn't mean that you should not sleep, you are still tired, but you are just kind of masking the effect, so you are not knowing that you are tired. So this is what caffeine does. It does not give energy, it kind of masks tiredness. And of course this is useful if you just have to do something. For example, if you have to drive a car while you are sleepy, that is a dangerous proposition. And if you are masking the tiredness, you are a little bit better on it. But if you are just using this every morning, for example, to wake up, that probably means that you should maybe sleep more because you are still tired, and not just kind of mask the tiredness with the caffeine. And of course in Finland we drink a lot of caffeine. So there are some, for example, in one cup of coffee there is around 100 milligrams of caffeine. And usually it is said that 400 milligrams of caffeine is already toxic. So how many people here drink 4 cups of coffee in the morning? Okay, and you are still alive. Yeah, this is the mystery of Finnish people. Yes. Yeah, but the thing is that if you get this caffeine all the time, you get this tolerance for it, so your brain kind of adapts. It wants to know where the adenosine levels are, so it's growing more adenosine receptors. And it is this caffeine is losing its power, so caffeine doesn't work anymore. It doesn't really give mask this tiredness anymore, so you get used to it. But what happens then at that point is that if you do not get enough caffeine, then you have this, your brain is having all these receptors that crave for something, and when you do not have caffeine, you will get these symptoms of withdrawal. So you will get headache, and feel extra tired because you are now caffeine dependent and you are not getting your fix. So the problem with the caffeine is that if you are using it a lot of it every day, it doesn't really give you much benefit, but then you cannot stop because otherwise you will get these withdrawal symptoms. So the most efficient way of using caffeine, if you need to use it for getting energy, is to use very little until you really need to, because then the effect is the largest. Of course, in coffee and especially in tea, there is actually many healthy things beside caffeine. So it might not be a bad idea to drink these every day, but then probably that doesn't really help you stay awake. But there is a lot of differences between people also. Some are very susceptible to this caffeine, and one cup of coffee is already getting this kind of shaky feeling. And some people can take much more. And if you are tolerant to it, you can drink a lot of it. But at least among children, in these energy drinks, there can be several hundred milligrams of caffeine, and if you take several of them and you are a small person or a children, you will probably get these caffeine poisoning symptoms. And they start with this kind of anxiety and need to move and a little bit shaking, but actually enough caffeine can cause cardiac arrest. And there are these cases where teenagers have killed themselves with energy drinks. So you can actually die from caffeine. But many people don't do that, of course. And caffeine has a half-life of around 6 hours. So in about 6 hours, half of the caffeine leaves your body. And that means that if you are susceptible to caffeine, you should stop drinking it at around 4 o'clock or some such kind of afternoon time, because if you are drinking it in the evening, it will make it harder for you to fall asleep. Okay. Do you have any questions about these caffeines? Yes. I also have some caffeine here.
Yeah. So I've heard from, not heard, but I read from somewhere that when you take a nap or something, you should, like, you could drink a cup of coffee and it helps you to refresh, like, quicker and make the sleep more efficient. So. Is there some kind of effect with that?
Yes, the idea here is that caffeine takes about half an hour to start affecting you. So if you are tired, you can drink caffeine and then go to sleep. And then around half an hour, when you have getting some sleep, the caffeine starts to kick in and then you wake up and you get both the benefit from the nap and the caffeine. So that might work for some people, yes.
Also, going probably in the end back a few slides, but I was curious with these hours, adult, was it 7 to 8 or around 8 on average?
Yes.
To be most beneficial. What is this in the end based on? You don't need to list all the publications, but is this based on experiments mostly, or is this based on statistics in the
These are mostly based on this epidemiological data, so you have tens of thousands or hundreds of thousands of people, and then we look at, that is the problem of course, that we have not measured how much they actually sleep, they self-report their sleep length, but if they self-report the 8 hours, then as a big group, they are the most healthy ones. And then these people who are having different amounts of sleep, they are not as healthy as those who have these 8 hours. So that is the main data. And of course, we have this experimental data of depriving people of their sleep. And from that, we know these negative effects. But it's hard to say that this concerns certain people. Kind of, it is statistical result, so it might not affect you. You might be the outlier. But in the big group that has kind of thousands or millions of people, most of them should probably sleep this much.
Well, but there is again, so in that sense, there's no cause effect here known either.
Yes,
so
it could be that it is correlation
that
in that,
that
sense.
For third reasons, people that have maybe shorter life expectancy or less ability to focus, or I don't know what, or more depression, also sleep not 7 to 9 hours, most of them.
Yeah, I mean, we know from these long sleepers, we do not really know the cause effect, but from these short sleepers, we can see in these experiments where we take people who usually sleep, for example, 7 hours, and then we deprive them of
but
3 hours,
people that
we can
usually
see negative effects.
6 hours, are they just as healthy in the end?
I mean, most people who sleep 7 to 9 hours are the healthiest ones. And those people who report in the statistical sense the 6 hours are not as healthy. But if we take some people to the lab and deprive them down to, for example, 5 hours, they will usually get negative effects.
Right. Okay, thanks.
Yes. Okay.
There is one more question.
I was wondering about the relationship of, or the effect of light on the generation of this hormone, was it adenosine, that makes you feel tired.
So yes.
Does that alter the production of that hormone? Or?
It doesn't affect adenosine, so it affects melatonin. We are coming to that a little bit later, but adenosine is only this chemical that accumulates all the time while you are awake. So it is not about the day of the time of the day. But that is a good question because we are now coming to this. That sleep is affected not only by the amount of time you spend awake, but it is also controlled by the circadian process. So sleep always happens in these cycles. So during sleep, there is this non-REM sleep, REM sleep cycle. And of course, during the day, there is this sleep-wake cycle. And in different animals, these cycles are different, so they have evolved to match the cycles of the environment. So we think that this natural sleep cycle is 24 hours and we are sleeping during the night and awake during the day. But then, for example, these creatures that live in the sea, they also have these cycles that correspond to the tides, for example, and lunar cycles. Okay, but first we can take a quick look of this, what happens during a night of sleep, usually. So what we have here in this picture is that there is the time of the night down here. And there are different sleep stages. So sleep has these non-REM stages that can be divided to different depths of 1 to 4. And during these stages, brain is relatively inactive and you have the resting part of the sleep. And then we have this REM sleep stage where brain is doing a lot of stuff. And that might be important for learning, emotional regulation. We do not really know. But during that time, brain is very active. And during the night, what usually happens is that when you fall asleep, you will start by sleeping a long period of this very deep non-REM sleep. And then you have a short period of REM sleep. And then you have more non-REM sleep and more REM sleep. And the amount of REM sleep becomes larger and larger during the night, and amount of non-REM sleep becomes smaller. And if you are sleep deprived, if you have the sleep debt, then you actually are paying back this non-REM sleep, so you will cut down the amount of REM sleep and get more of this deep sleep. So that seems to be more important for health. What is the kind of relevance for your own sleeping is that usually if you have trouble staying asleep, you will wake up during these REM sleep periods and then you might be sleeping again. So usually people who have this insomnia that doesn't prevent them from falling asleep, but then they wake up around 2 o'clock because then the first non-REM sleep stage is over and they will rise to this REM sleep, but they might then awaken if they have too great arousal. And also, before waking up, you usually wake up from these REM sleep states because it's so prevalent during the morning. And that is the states that you usually remember your dreams from. If you are waking up from around here, you might not remember anything. Okay. But maybe the more interesting cycle is this circadian cycle, so day-night cycle. And this affects, again, many animals. So already around 300 years ago, there was this scientist, academic man called Demiran. And he was very practical scientist. He had this mimosa plant. And this plant is such that during the day it has open leaves, and during the night it closes its leaves. And this Demiran was thinking that, is it this because of the light, or does the plant know the time? So he made this experiment that he put the plant in a box. So it was dark all the time. And then during the day, he very quickly peeked into the box that what happens with the leaves. And what he found out is that even if there was complete darkness during the whole day, the plant was opening the leaves when it was a day and closing them during the night. So the plant had this biological clock. It knew the time. And then we had to wait a couple of hundred years. And these German scientists, Jürgen Askoff and Rutger Weber, thought that we should do this with humans. So we take these humans, people, and put them in the box and see what happens. And what they did was they constructed this place without time. So there was this bunker underground. And in the bunker, there was always constant light. And there was no clocks. And nothing was heard from outside world into the bunker. And they took these volunteers and put them there for 2 weeks without any way of knowing the time. And they brought them food at random intervals, so they did not know what time it was from the food. And then they measured their core temperature and many things. And the idea here was that if humans also have this biological clock, then they should keep the same time as before, even if they don't have any time signals. And they kind of did. So they kept this around 24-hour cycle of sleep and wake, even without knowing anything about the time. But it usually did not stay stable, so it started to shift. So it was not exactly 24 hours. And that meant that after 2 weeks, when they came out, they were in the completely different time zone than when they left. So the night could have shifted, for example, 8 hours to some direction. And then there were some outliers who had this very strange phenomenon of doubling their circadian time. So they actually had this 48 hours day where they slept for 16 hours and then they were awake for 24 hours. And they didn't notice it. They said that that was a one day. But they had a cycle. It was just a very strange cycle. But what we learned from these experiments is that actually all animals, actually all cells have biological clocks. And humans also have this biological clock. And it is much easier for us to fall asleep when our biological clock says that it is a night than if it says that it's a day. And this doesn't depend on how tired we are. So even if we are very tired, it is hard for us to fall asleep during the day, and it's easy for us to fall asleep during the night. And this day and night is determined by our inner clock, not by the environment directly. Okay. Some technical terms here, but the take-home message is that this biological clock is running inside of us, but it needs to be synchronized with the environment or it is useless. But because the environment changes, so for example, in Finland we have this dark winters and very light summers, we know that this clock must be synchronized with the environment. It can't be constant all the time. And how it does it is that it gets these signals called Zeitgebers, time givers, from the environment that set our clock to the environment. And the most important one is light. So when the light hits our eyes, they are actually this third type of cell, so not a cone and not a rod, but just this kind of strictly photosensitive ganglion cell, that is a bad name for it, that only knows that if there is a light or if there is not light. And that signals directly this pineal complex and suprachiasmatic nucleus in our brain that keep this time, this biological clock that we have. And this is by seeing light, our biological clock is set to the same rhythm as the actual day. Okay. But this is in theory. So in the environment where we evolved in, there was this very logical thing that when it was night, it was dark. When it was day, it was light. And during sunset, there was this red light. And during sunrise, there was more of this blue light. But now we have light from all over the place at whatever time we want. And this might mess up this clock that we have. So our clock works in such a way that if we see bright bluish light in the evening, it thinks that we are in the wrong time zone and it delays the sleeping so that we would get to the more correct time zone. It thinks that it is not night yet. And what people these days do before they are falling asleep is that they are using these bluish LED screens close to their eyes to emit light to their biological clock. And for some people, at least, this should delay the biological clock. But we collected some data about this in University of Turku from high schoolers. So we asked them that how many of you use these electric devices, smart devices, before bedtime, last hour before bedtime. And I think in 3,000 or so people, there were six who did not use some smart device right before falling asleep. So it seems that most of them still slept well. So this will not destroy the sleeping of most of the people. But there might be people who have so sensitive biological clock that it is moving their clock all the time, and that might be a problem for them. Okay. Yes, and to come to the melatonin, that now everyone wants to sell you melatonin that you would sleep better. But it might help you, but only under certain circumstances. So what melatonin is, it is a hormone that is secreted in the darkness. And if you get light, it is not secreted. And this means that it is one of the mechanisms of these state gapers. So it is setting your biological clock. That is what melatonin does. So when it becomes dark, you will secrete melatonin, and it tells your biological clock that it is a night. And that means that if you are taking melatonin as a medicine, if you are taking it in the middle of the day in the bright sunlight, it doesn't really do anything for you. You should take it before, couple of hours before you should be falling asleep, and don't use a lot of light at the same time. And that is actually advancing your clock, so your biological rhythm is becoming more morning type. And that might help you fall asleep if your problem is that actually this your circadian rhythm is too late. But if your problem is some kind of strong insomnia, the melatonin will not put you to sleep. It is not hypnotic. It is just setting your clock in certain direction. So it is most useful for these problems that are coming from shift work or jet lag or these kind of things. And it is not very effective for insomnia as such. But it seems to be very harmless. So you can try it out if you want to. It probably doesn't do anything bad for you, but it might not help in every circumstances. Okay. And my favorite subject about this biological clock is that even in the environment, the same environment, different people have different biological clocks. So for some people, if they get the light at the same time and the darkness at the same time, their day and night actually are not in the same place because their biological clock works differently. And that means that we have these different types of people. We have morning people, and we have evening people, and we have something in between. And this is not by choice. This is actually this chronotype, this type when you are most active, can be measured from your melatonin secretion and also your body temperature. So it is a biological thing. And there is a limited amount of stuff that you can actually do to it. So if you have your own whole life, it has been hard for you to wake up early in the morning, that is not kind of something that you can change. It is something that is in your genes. Fortunately for Finnish adults, 44% of them are these morning types. that awake quite early and feel most energetic in the mornings, and then fall asleep pretty early also. Another 40% are these day types that are very much in the same rhythm as the society is. So they would like to wake up at 7 o'clock and go to work and feel energetic there. But then we have this 13% that are the evening types. And these people like to wake up late, and also they fall asleep pretty late. And they might have most energy in the evenings. And the problem with these people is that they really cannot fall asleep during their biological clock day. And that means that it's very hard for them to fall asleep early enough so that they would get the 8 hours before they have to wake up. So some people, these evening chronotypes might, for example, fall asleep at 2 o'clock or 3 o'clock if they are on their own inner circadian rhythm, and that means that they have only 5 to 4 hours before they have to wake up, if they have to wake up at 7 o'clock. And that is a problem because these evening types are not as healthy as the other types. They have these cardiovascular problems and mood problems and all kinds of problems that seems to be related to chronic sleep deprivation. So they are probably not unhealthier as such, but they just don't get enough sleep as the other chronotypes. And the thing about this evening type is that it is also affected by age. So your chronotype becomes more evening type when you are a teenager, and then it becomes more morning type as you get older. So that means that people are at their max eveningness during their teenage years. And as we all know, teenagers are all the time tired and they do not want to wake up. And they still have to, because there is this law in Finland that says that they have to go to school, and school starts at certain times. And this is actually pretty bad mixture. So there are a lot of people, if you are evening type and you are as evening type as you are ever going to be during your teenage years, and you are still growing and you should learn, and then you have to wake up too early, there isn't too much that you can do to shift your type, and then you are very tired. And actually, it would be easier to shift the school start times than to shift these evening types. But of course, that is societal thing, and this is it seems that it is actually not so easy. But as a sleep scientist, I would say that that would be the way to go. Okay. Do you have any problems? Problems. Questions related to these.
Is there a difference between sexes? Like, are there like more like from what I, from personal experience, know that teenage boys like me were like mostly all owls, but then I think the girls had much easier time waking up in the morning and being more active, and all the guys were sleeping at the desk. And
yeah, actually, among adults, so there are more women evening types than men. So it's on the different direction. So I don't know, is it really easy for girls also during teenage years? But it might also be because this, of course, you cannot choose your chronotype, but you can affect it by this light exposure. And if you are doing stuff in the evening that involves a lot of light, for example, or playing on the computer, it makes you even more evening type. So that might affect this thing somewhat. But I don't know, these days everyone uses these smart devices, regardless of the sex, so yeah. I cannot say about this observation. It is not theoretically sound, but I think I had the same experience, so it should be studied more. Yes.
Yeah, I wanted to ask about melatonin. You said that when you give pure melatonin, it just makes the body think that it's the other time.
Yes.
But melatonin is produced in the body from the amino acid tryptophan.
Yes.
And you know, when it's dark, it produces melatonin. When it's light, it produces serotonin.
Yes.
What is your opinion about this? If you go back to the base,
where it's produced from. Would it be better to have tryptophan or melatonin?
I think that if you want to do something about your sleep, you should kind of take the melatonin, but of course you could have some problems if you do not have enough of this precursor. And of course you also need serotonin to kind of not be depressed. So it is very important to have this tryptophan. But if you want to shift your clock kind of right now, then you can just take melatonin, because if it's on the right time, it will do something for you. And if you just would take this precursor, then it depends on the light circumstances that what comes out.
Yes, I remember when I was a kid and I couldn't fall asleep, my mother gave me warm milk and a banana.
Yes.
And that helps.
Yeah. And actually, we know that during night time, the cows secrete melatonin into the milk. And there has been this product in Finland that this milk that has been kind of, what's the word in English? Lypsää, taken out of the cow during the night. And that has more melatonin, and that should help you sleep better. But the melatonin concentration in that milk is very low, so.
Statistically relevant.
Yeah.
Yeah, about the owl types. I've heard also that your day rhythm can be 25 hours. So, for example, being a night person, you might have a 25-hour day instead of a 24 or 23-hour day.
Yes.
Is that also true?
That is true. Sort of and actually, most people have 24 hours and some minutes, 15 minutes or so. And that means that If we are in the environment where we are not controlling our sleeping rhythm in any way, then it starts to shift towards later time. And that is because the clock is not exactly 24 hours. And then we have to kind of sometimes wake up too early to shift it back. And then there are people who actually have this clinical problem that their clock is something like 25 or 26 hours, and it shifts a couple of hours a day, and it's very hard for them to keep the night in the one place, and that can be very big problem. And you can try to treat that with a strong bright light in the morning and melatonin in the evening, so that it would kind of shift it back. But that is true that some people have different length of the day than other people. Yes.
So, excuse me if I accuse you of this, but there is apparently some inconsistency. On the one hand, you said first there's this circadian rhythm, which works roughly independent of environmental stimuli.
Yeah, that is the
and
biological
on the other
clock.
Hand, where like just like one evening I take some melatonin a couple of hours before I want to go to sleep, and then it tells me that it's night. So where is the line here? How strong or what period is the inner clock running its course anyway, and how much of melatonin or light do I need, how often, until the clock gets reset or changed?
The idea here is that you have this inner clock, and what is the problem with the clock? It is not so that it cannot be affected by the environment. It is so that it can only be shifted little while per one day. So at maximum, usually, you can shift the clock for 1 hour if you get these shadecapers at the right time. So if you get melatonin or darkness in the evening and bright light in the morning, melatonin more early in the evening than usually, you can shift it only for 15 minutes or half an hour or 1 hour or something like that. And that means that you also have to take the shadecaper at the correct time, so usually in the evening or bright light in the morning. But you cannot shift it, for example, 12 hours by taking melatonin in the middle of the day. That doesn't make the day the night. But if you take it in the evening, you can shift it a little bit. So it is shifted by the environment, but it can only go so far in one direction in one day. Okay. Yes.
What about, I feel like going from Europe to US, that way it's a lot easier to go to the US time zone, like reset the clock, but then coming back, it seems like it's a lot more harder to get back on the European Finnish time.
And that is because of this effect that our clock is usually a little bit longer than 24 hours. And that means it shifts more easily forward or later time than earlier time. So it is much harder to wake up early every day than to stay up late every day. And that means that when you are doing this jet traffic, it is easier to move eastwards than to move westwards than to move eastwards. And that is why it's easier to fly to United States and stay up late there than to fly back and then wake up early.
And the perfect solution would be that when you want to come back, you don't fly straight to Europe, you just fly once.
Yeah, you fly over there. Yeah. You stay one day in every time zone and you go over the whole globe, and that would be okay. Yes. Then a little bit about these sleep problems. So the media wants us to believe that problems related to sleeping are on the rise, and the scientists are not so sure. We know that during the last decade we have some evidence that sleep duration has shortened, and insomnia has definitely become more common, but that is because we now have better diagnosis procedures for that. And people use more of this sleeping medicine, but of course sleeping medicine was not so widely available earlier. So we are not sure if there is this rising trend, but at least we know that many people have problems with sleeping these days. Okay. And if you do not get enough sleep for one night, many irritating things happen. So you have lowered mood, you have a slight reduction in cognition, especially in relation to your attention and working memory and decision making, but usually for a couple of hours, if you concentrate, you can reach the same level as a person who has been sleeping enough for one day or so. You have this increased risk of infections, but then you sleep enough for or a little bit more than usual for one night or two, and you will get rid of all this. And this happens to all of us, of course. And really the only thing that you should really worry about with acute sleep deprivation is that you might not want to drive when you are sleep deprived, especially during night, because actually most of these accidents that have led to death in Finland, these traffic accidents, have been happened during early hours of the night, and the person, well, we cannot of course know in every circumstances, but they might have been falling asleep. So that is pretty dangerous. But this chronic sleep deprivation, and that means that you will not get enough sleep for months or years, this is very unhealthy. It seems to be increasing risk of pretty much anything that has been studied. So it increases risk of getting diabetes, getting cardiovascular problems, hypertension, chronic pain, obesity actually, depression, memory problems, and all-cause mortality. So people who have been sleeping too little for years are worse off in many ways. And the problem here, of course, is the shift work. So I would not recommend shift work for decades for anyone, because there has been these quite alarming studies that people who have done shift work for 10 years, tens of decades, have this kind of cognitive level and health level that is of a person who is should be 20 years older. So they have kind of, everything is a little bit worse off. Yes.
Yes, coming back to this chronic sleep deprivation, and you don't have in this list, you don't have Alzheimer.
Yes, and it should be there because there has been now studies.
Yeah,
about
and I wanted to comment on that because you know this term glymphatic cycle in the brain. That's the wild animals have it, we have it.
Yes.
So when the wild animal is out in the forest for a day, it's very stressful, right?
Yes.
And the stress makes the stress hormones go up, and the brain starts to produce this amyloid plague, you know.
Yeah.
But the animals, when they go into their nest or cave or whatever, and they sleep, when they go into the deep sleep, what happens in the brain is that the tubes, the myelin tubes in the brain, they open up, and the spinal liquid washes away the amyloid plaque, and that happens with us also.
Yeah, it does. Yes.
And that means that if you don't sleep enough, you develop Alzheimer. So you believe in this theory. It has been proved, but what do you
think?
Yeah,
I have seen a couple of kind of very high impact articles about this, so I do not have any reason to doubt it.
Yeah.
So the one of the benefits of the sleep is that it's kind of washing up your brain. So
exactly, because yeah. You have this lymphatic cycle.
Yes. Yes.
You have spoken about what happens when there is lack of sleep, but I've also heard that there are some people who can't stay awake at all. If you're just sitting, you know, they fall asleep. If
yeah.
they're not speaking or if they're not doing anything, they just fall asleep. So why does that happen? Is it because of like over secretion of a hormone or?
Well, there are different conditions that can cause it, and narcolepsy is maybe this most well known, because we in Finland had this tragic incident that one of the vaccines for this big flu caused narcolepsy in people who had this very rare genetic vulnerability for that. And what happens in narcolepsy is that in brain there is this system that controls your sleep and wake, and usually there are lot of these pressures for one side or another. So if you are even very strongly sleeping or very strongly awake. But in narcolepsy, these orexin producing neurons that are responsible for this system are destroyed. And that means that kind of the switch from sleep to wake is very loose, and it can go from either side very quickly. And that means that these people, they actually sleep poorly, but they also don't stay awake very well. And if they get excited, they usually fall asleep kind of in catastrophic manner. So that is a very serious condition. It is problem in the brain. But then, of course, if you have enough sleep deprivation, even without really having any problems, you will get these microsleeps. So people probably cannot die from the sleep deprivation, because your brain always takes sleep from somewhere. So if people are, if we try to keep people awake for too long, even if they don't notice it, they will get these very short sleep periods all the time. So the brain will not allow it that we do not sleep at all. And that is also what happens to people who are very tired and they are driving the car, so they might get these microsleeps. And if there is something happening during that period that you should react to, they are not reacting to it. Yes. Okay. So if you are not sleeping for one night, you will survive. If you are not sleeping for years, that is very bad for you. Okay. Then, of course, the most common sleep disorder is insomnia. And around 8% of Finnish adults have these frequent insomnia symptoms during the last month, so that is a lot of people. And probably almost everyone has these insomnia episodes during their lives, so they cannot get to sleep even if they are very tired. But the problem with insomnia is that it is not one thing. Insomnia is usually a symptom of something. And maybe the most common cause for insomnia is stress. So if you are thinking all the time that if you are worrying all the time about something, or something bad has happened and you are thinking about what to do with it, or if you are scared of something or this kind of things, then in evolutionary sense your brain is telling you that it's dangerous, you should not sleep, you should stay awake and be aware of the tiger in the woods. But the problem is that we have very little tigers anymore. And if we have the problem, for example, that we are worried about exam that is coming next day and we cannot fall asleep because of that, that doesn't make any sense. But that is how our brain works, that if we are stressed out, it doesn't want to sleep too much. And usually this kind of insomnia, well, you cannot say that getting rid of the stress is easy. But if you can get rid of the stress, the sleeping returns back to normal. Then there are also these insomnia that you can kind of inflict on yourself by leading a life that doesn't let you sleep. For example, or having such a working schedule that you cannot sleep when you should be sleeping, and you should sleep at the wrong time of the day, and using a lot of caffeine and losing a lot of bright light. And this makes it hard for the body to maintain good sleep. And then there are many somatic illnesses that can also cause insomnia. And there are more about, doctors should treat them. I cannot really say much of them. Okay. Yes. But something that I can say more is this jet lag that we already talked about. So usually when people travel several time zones, they get these complaints that they are tired, but they still have problems falling asleep. They also have problems concentrating, they are feeling cold, and they might not want to eat during the day, and they might want to eat during the night. And this is because the biological clock says that it is a night when they are trying to live a day, and it's a day when they are trying to live a night. So this is the best example when you see that your biological clock is misaligned with the environment. And there is not much that you can do about this, because of course the jet lag goes away when your biological clock catches up to the actual environment. But the biological clock is slow, so it usually can shift at maximum of 1 hour per day. So if you are, for example, going somewhere where there is 7 hours time difference, it will probably take you a week to reach the same internal time as the external time is. And then you are usually coming back again, and then you have to take another week. So this is problematic. Melatonin might be able to help in this jet lag. And of course, as we already talked about, it is easier to delay the clock, so stay up late, than to advance it. So if you are going somewhere where you should be waking up 10 hours before your normal time, it might be easier to just go the other way around, so stay so late up that you actually take the other way around the clock and not try to wake up earlier, that much earlier. To recover from this jet lag, you should expose yourself to light when there is a day in the new place.
Yeah, I wanted to ask about the jet lag, because when I travel across the time zones,
yes,
what I do is that when I land, I sort of mentally force myself to think that this is the right time, not the wrong time. Because usually people, they think that, this is not the right time. The Finland time is this, so you think the Finnish time. So you behave and you do things at the time of the destination, not the time of the where you left.
And that probably makes you shift your clock faster than if you would.
So you mean that you can mentally force yourself?
Yeah, because many things besides light are also jet gapers. So this physical activity and eating times and these kind of things affect it. So if you kind of force yourself to the new schedule, it will you will shift your clock faster, but it will not be instantaneous, of course.
Just out of curiosity, can you totally like destroy the biological clock cycle thing, like you have 3 hours of sleep during night, 3 hours during day, and that's different times the whole time? So is it always that 24-25 hour shift, or can you like totally make it?
You can break it at least in two ways. So if you stay in this if you stay awake a very long time and don't have much jet gapers, it kind of leaves it hanging so that you can shift it 10 hours or 12 hours or something. They will say that you crush your circadian rhythm, that you stay awake, for example, 40 or 50 hours and do not have just have constant light all the time. So it kind of loses track of the whole environment. And then it is easier to kind of shift it a lot in one go. So I do not recommend it, but if you are traveling to another continent and you stay awake for 3 days or 4 days, then probably you will get to the new rhythm at once, but you are very sleep deprived. And then some people have tried to do this very exotic kind of rhythm, so that, for example, that they are 1 hour asleep and then 2 hours awake and 1 hour asleep and something like that during the whole rhythm. And some people say that it kind of works for them, but I don't know if it has been measured, that is the kind of circadian process really going that way, or are they just forcing themselves and it doesn't kill them.
So basically it's usually about the same with everyone, and you have to shift it with like 15 to 1 hour per day.
Yeah, it's about 24 to 25 hours. And well, if you are playing with this radical sleep deprivation, it can shift more. But I have experienced it myself, that for example, because I'm evening type, my clock doesn't really go backwards at all. So when I went to Australia, I didn't sleep for a couple of days, and then I slept something like 16 hours, and then it had shifted something like 8 hours. It was not in the right place, but it was not so that I would stay. I was waking up too early, not staying up too late. So sometimes it can go to random places in these extreme circumstances. So you cannot always predict where your internal time will be if you are doing this very kind of hardcore trip to different time zone.
Yes. Maybe because there are a lot of people, for example, working in a university, who are often traveling a lot to different time zones, yes, and staying there for 1 or 2 days yes, and then coming back. And if it is possible, say if they have to go just to a conference and give a talk, they just don't change their clock. I mean, they just, yes, stay in the time zone where they come from, because it's much easier.
And that is what you should do, yeah, because you cannot really gain anything by trying to shift your clock 10 hours in 1 day. So if you are doing this very short trip, you should just stay in your own time zone and then do what you have to do in the strained time, but otherwise do not try to shift the clock at all. And also, if you are on a holiday to somewhere where you do not have any schedule, but there is a lot of time difference, you might get more out of it if you are not really trying to shift your clock, but just staying up at the different time that other people, because then you do not get the jet lag if you are just living your own rhythm. You are just living very different rhythm, but if that's okay on your holiday, that might also work. Yes. Okay. But there's other kind of circadian misalignment that you can get. You do not have to go to different continent, you just have to take an alarm clock and put it ringing 3 hours before you wake up. And then you have jet lag if you're doing that every day. So this social jet lag is maybe the most prevalent sleep problem in the world. And it simply means that your biological clock is kind of incompatible with the schedule that you are putting it through. So it's very hard, for example, to people to do shift work. Some people do it better than others, but it is not really natural for anyone. Evening types rising early are problematic. Morning types partying late are problematic. So everyone in the university is sleep deprived, even if they are evening types or morning types. And usually almost all teens starting school at 8 o'clock have this social jet lag. So their biological time is not aligned with that kind of schedule. And it might be, if they are very, very hard with themselves and use melatonin and bright light, they might get it there. But if they want to live normal life, it just doesn't. It is going forward all the time and it is problematic. And the social jet lag, if you get many hours of it, you will get the same problems as with different normal jet lag, and you will also get sleep deprivation. So yeah, I know that I'm very grateful that some people stay up during the night to drive ambulances and do this kind of stuff. And also many people do not have any control over the schedule of their work. But if you do have control over the schedule of your work, I would say that there isn't any reason for you to stay work from 8 to 4 hours, because many people do it, because if it's not your natural rhythm, it is completely okay to go to work at noon and stay at 8 o'clock if you are evening type and you can manage that. And that will probably have health benefits in the long run. But I know some people that think that this is somehow bad just because it is usually not done. So this is a kind of attitude thing for some people. But for many people, of course, the society forces them to some schedule. And there is quite little they can do about that. Okay. There are a lot of sleep problems. I will just list some of them. So if you want to hear about some specific one, you can ask them. I will not go over them in any great length. Nightmares is a very interesting one. It is not really a sleep problem. It is a problem of dreaming. And it is usually related to these traumatic experiences during wake, if it's pathological. But of course, everyone has nightmares sometimes. Sleep apnea is very common, especially among older people. And this is not a problem with sleep, but it is a problem with breathing during the sleep. So that you have these pauses in breathing during sleep. That can be, it can be caused by several things. And that causes micro awakenings and sleep deprivation. And it can be treated with these machines that actually are forcing air to your lungs so that you cannot stop breathing during sleep. Restless legs, quite interesting one, but it can be treated quite easily. It is something that people have this urge to move their legs all the time when they are falling asleep, and they cannot fall asleep because they are moving their legs. And it actually can be treated with medicine quite efficiently, strangely enough. REM sleep behavior disorder is a very exotic one and not very, very common, but what happens here is that during REM sleep, you usually have this muscle paralysis. And during this disorder, you are not paralyzed during REM sleep. And what happens then is that when you have exciting dreams, you start to act them out in your bed. And then you can hit yourself or your partner or run towards the wall, and it can be quite dangerous. It can be also treated with medicine. Sleep talking, walking, and sleep eating and doing other stuff during the sleep are not uncommon and usually not dangerous, but they can be very strange. And they usually happen during non-REM sleep, especially during with children. And if it's not causing any practical problems, it is not dangerous. But some people have even kind of gone to their car and started it and done these kind of things. Some people, the sleep eating is also very interesting because some people have tried to eat, for example, frozen meat and broken their teeth. And these kind of things can happen. Yeah. Seasonal affective disorder. The problem in Finland is that during the winter, we do not have any light, so our biological clock doesn't know how to set it itself. And for some people, this causes these mood problems. Especially if you are moving to Finland from places where there is a more robust day and light cycle. But there are these studies about seasonal affective disorder that it doesn't always correlate with the amount of light. So this might not be the explanation, the end-all explanation for it, this darkness. My personal favorite, exploding head syndrome. And this is a real thing, and it is very inconvenient. The symptom is that when you are falling asleep, you feel this, hear this very loud voice inside your head, and then you wake up, and then you cannot fall asleep. And not much is known about it, but other than that many people have it, so it exists. Yes. Any one of these that you want some?
I'm just curious about the restless legs.
Yes.
Because during when we're trying to sleep, you know, our body is telling all the other parts also that it's going to sleep. But why is that, you know, you have this thing that you want to move your legs so much?
It was related to deficiency in some mineral, but I don't remember. Dopamine. dopamine deficiency. Magnesium maybe also. Yeah, but it could be treated with having enough of these. So it was kind of chemical thing. So it isn't related to normal sleep processes, but it was deficiency in some chemical.
Is the restless legs related to like when you're falling asleep and you get a spasm or something? So
it is kind of different thing. Those are more normal. Almost everyone has these kind of muscle twitches when they are falling asleep. But the restless legs is kind of more like this feeling that you have to move them because they are uncomfortable.
Okay, then I have a question about, I don't remember it in English, but in Finnish it's unihalvaus.
Yes, sleep paralysis.
Yeah, sleep paralysis. So does it fit in that list? Or
yes, it could have been here. So sleep paralysis is this very scary experience that you wake up but you cannot move, so you are paralyzed. And you often also see some hallucinations in your bedroom. And that happens actually, it is a little bit related to this REM sleep behavior disorder. So during REM sleep you have this muscle paralysis. And during sleep paralysis you wake up before that paralysis has worn off. So it is actually harmless. So you are supposed to be paralyzed during REM sleep, but you are just not supposed to be waking up so quickly that the paralysis is still active. And usually in a couple of minutes the paralysis kind of lets go and then everything is normal, but the experience is very nasty. And many people have it once or twice in their lifetime, some people have it more, but it is not dangerous. So if you know what it is, it you can handle it, but it is very not nice experience to wake up paralyzed. Yes.
The rest of the legs, that's mainly because of poor blood circulation. Because when you have poor blood circulation in your feet, for example, the body itself wants to make the blood flow, and then you have these movements of the muscle.
Yeah, that you
can
might
help,
be.
That you can help with magnesium.
Yes.
So how do you manage seasonal affective disorder?
The most efficient way to treat it is this bright light therapy. So because there is no light outside, you will take this very strong bright lamp with you and look at it half an hour every morning.
Oh my God.
We seem to lost the light. And that might be harder to treat actually. I have not really read on treating the summer version. The winter version is with bright light therapy, but that of course doesn't work if you have too much light. Yes. I'll be back. We are back. Okay, so how is the time? Do I talk about this one study or do we skip to the end?
I would be curious. We are close to half past six.
Sorry.
The time for the questions and answers.
But if everyone agrees, maybe we can continue a little bit with the, because it was very interesting. So maybe we continue with the last part and then.
I will try to be quick about mm-hmm. this, because there's this one very cool study a couple of years ago that was done, because of course the one explanation for this rise of sleep problems or potential rise of sleep problems is that everyone in Western society is now using these smartphones and doing stuff that is breaking their sleep. So the question then comes to mind that what about these people who do not have any technology? How do they sleep? And this research group from Yetis and colleagues went and put these devices on these pre-industrial populations that measured sleep. So people who are these hunter-gatherer lifestyle people in Africa and South America who do not have electricity at all. So they were still living like humans lived tens of thousands of years ago. And they put these actigraph devices on their wrist that measured how much they sleep and at what time and what kind of sleeping conditions they have. Okay. And they had these people wore these actigraphs over a year. So these people, they slept mostly outside, so not within buildings. They were usually sleeping naked with these light blankets on the ground. And the temperature during night started at around 25 degrees and dropped to 15 degrees during the night before it started to rise again in the morning. And these participants slept in family groups and they never slept alone. So here are already quite a bit differences to what how we are sleeping in Western world. Oh, they did not have artificial light, they did not have any devices, they were not sleeping alone, and they were sleeping in conditions where there was a lot of fresh air and dropping temperature during the night. Okay. And what was found out was that they actually slept the same amount as Western people. So maybe this 6 to 7 hours is natural, quite okay. Okay. They went to sleep during darkness, so the sun had already set, and they did not fall asleep when the lights went out, so to speak, but they stay awake about 3 hours after sunset. And they did not wake up when the sun came up, but they wake up 1 hour before sunrise. There was actually, do I have it here? That was the temperature minimum of the day, so it was as cold as it was ever going to get. And when it started to get a little bit warmer, then they wake up. That was interesting. And it was very regular. Sleep duration was 1 hour longer in their winter than in their summer, even if the difference in the winter and summer was just a couple of hours of daylight. And this would mean that if we would just use the same formula for us, people in Lapland should sleep something like 20 hours a day in the winter. But what we can learn from here is at least that it is natural to sleep longer when the days are shorter. Okay. Yes. And the onset and offset of the sleep followed the temperature, not the light. And of course, we do not have that at all in our bedrooms because we have the constant temperature all the time because that's how our buildings are done. But many people like to open their windows, actually, and that drops the temperature. So the temperature might be important.
But it's, how is that clear from that? Because the temperature can only rise once there is radiation, right? So it doesn't get warmer 2 hours before it gets light. So it's
yeah, it was the minimum. I mean, they had this vasoconstriction also, so they were, I think you could say that they were very cold when they woke up. There were temperature measurements taken also in their sleeping sites. And usually during this minimum temperature, there was no clear explanation what was the mechanism, but during the minimum temperature of the environment, they woke up before the sunrise when the temperature started to go up. So something about the temperature was affecting their sleep-wake cycle. Yes. And of course the light exposure, they had most light exposure in the morning. During the noon they were actually seeking shade because it was too hot. And during the night they had around 5 lux. And this is logarithmic scale and smartphone produces around 100 lux. So there was very darkness when they were sleeping. Okay, and they did not nap during the day. So here is a picture that is visualizing the difference of light exposure that these people had. So these hunter-gatherers, and only 2% say that they had these symptoms more than once a year. So if this communication was successful, it might not have been because there were problems communicating about these issues. It seems that these people have very little these insomnia symptoms or sleep disorders. And from this study, we could say that, of course, these people have other health problems, so they are not better off in every regard. But in regarding this regularly getting good nights of sleep, they are better off than Western people. So there might be something that we could learn from their way of sleeping that might help people in also our culture. Okay. Yes. But to sum the things up, why would you want to sleep? And that is because if you have a very good night's sleep, you actually get benefits. Your cognitive functions work better, your mood regulation works better, and your immune system works better. And also, this is important for getting benefits from exercise and growing up. And if you are not getting enough sleep, you are not getting these positive effects. And if you are not getting enough sleep for a long time, you actually start to get health problems. And how you should do it? I would say that it is pretty important to know how much sleep do you actually need, and also what is your natural rhythm. Because if you do not know those things, it's hard to know when you should sleep and how much. And after you know those things, then you can take a look at your schedule and see that if you can manage to have enough sleep and hopefully at right time, you will probably feel better. But of course, it is hard sometimes in our society to have the sleep we want at the same time we want. And these small things before bedtime, avoid bright light, caffeine, exciting stuff, exercise, anything that raises your arousal, because that makes falling asleep harder. And if you have these sleep problems, you should not just ignore them and say that everyone has these, because they have health consequences. So you should try to do something about them. Okay. So that is for the slides. Sorry for going overtime three times overtime, but that is how it goes.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
It was, of course, very interesting, and I know that there have been already several questions, and that's why also it lasted a little bit longer, yeah. But this is exactly what we planned to have and wanted to have. But I know that there is here one question immediately.
Hi, I remember a graph about this stages of sleep.
Yes.
Is it the the graph of a sleep cycle, or how it happens during the night? I mean, like for evening person who sleeps at 3 but can wake up at 12, for example, having 8 hours of sleep. Like, would that person still has this healthy sleep, or just like part of it?
Yes. So this is what usually happens during your night sleep or your sleeping period. It doesn't matter when you have it. So the night person can have it this same structure starting from 3 o'clock, and morning person can have it starting at 9 o'clock. But they will have the same structure of the sleep.
A very related question. So if you take drugs, like hypnotic drugs,
yes.
So in which stage are you in? And what happens?
Yeah, that's a good question, because it depends what kind of hypnotic you take, but it will kind of break this. So you can have something, usually something non-REM-like, but it might not be completely the non-REM that you are used to. So some of these older hypnotics, they will make you fall to sleep, kind of, but you might not get this structure, and you might not wake up feeling refreshed. And then maybe the most common hypnotic in the world, that is alcohol. It actually is a REM sleep suppressant. So when you fall asleep and you have taken a lot of alcohol, you will not get these REM periods at the early part of the night. But then alcohol is burned away from your body so quickly that during the last hours of your sleeping, you do not have it anymore. And then you are getting this REM rebound, so you are getting all the REM sleep in the last hours of the night, because you should have the REM sleep, brain is trying to compensate, you have this REM sleep depth from that night. And that is why you might have very vivid dreaming during the last nights of the alcohol night, because you are having all the REM sleep at the one time, and it is likely that you will wake up from that. Yes.
You'd mentioned that you know, before you go to sleep, you shouldn't do anything exciting or exercise. But I've heard both sides of the argument where that if you, for example, hit the gym before you sleep, A, you're too tired that you cannot sleep, or that you're so tired that your body thinks that it needs rest and it needs to sleep. So is it just dependent from person to person, or is
it
there?
It is dependent on person to person. So okay. Exercise is good for sleep. So you should do exercise, you are sleeping better. But many people, couple of hours after they have done this exercise, their body is kind of in this energetic state. So even if you are feeling tired, the body is actually working still from the exercise, and that makes it harder to fall asleep. So some people cannot fall asleep right after exercise, but you should exercise then earlier in the day.
Because I asked before a question. So. About this REM sleep, two things. One that is also going back to the other slide. You said that the REM sleep syndrome obviously happens in REM sleep, so that
yes. You're
living out your dreams and you're not you're not hindered by the body own drugs to move. But then you talked about sleepwalking. You said, if I remember right, that it happens in the
non-REM sleep.
In the yes. non-REM sleep or in the deepest
yes.
sleep.
Because
so maybe just if you can, I find this very interesting, but I'm most fascinated by asking, okay, what really even happens, you know, like in sleep, in the different phases of sleep. So how can that be that on the one hand you're sort of in the deepest sleep and then you're like going outside and driving like driving your car or something. So that how can that fit together? And then the other thing, going to the last remark that you made about the alcohol, for me personally, it seems it doesn't really matter if I sleep 3 or 5 hours much, but somehow from these last 1 or 2 hours when there is a lot of REM sleep, that seems to be, at least in the sense of well-being, not maybe like getting up maybe hard when you sleep only 2 or 3 hours, but then like the difference between 7 and 8 or whatever happened, like when the time is for the REM sleep, that seems to be largest. And I would like you to comment on that a little bit once more, like, because you once said the non-REM sleep is apparently the most important because that's what happens first.
How
does that go together?
I'm not sure if I get it. So you are saying that if you are not getting enough sleep, you usually lose more REM sleep.
Yes, but yes. That apparently that makes more of a difference. Or that's my experience. So is this my imagination, or is this something that is known? Like
The idea here is that when you are sleep deprived, you will pay most of the non-REM sleep debt first. So from that we have concluded that the non-REM sleep for the body and the brain, it wants to get at least that. For some reason, for health reasons. But of course, losing any sleep, and you usually really lose more REM sleep if you are waking up too early, is of course having this effect on the mood and cognition. And it might be that the REM sleep, we are kind of treading on the thin ice here, so there is not really completely understanding of this, but many people say that the REM sleep and the dreaming during REM sleep might be most important for this mood regulation, this emotional regulation. And that might mean that if you lose that, it would feel bad. But then we have these experiments where we have deprived people of all of their REM sleep and nothing bad seems to happen, and let them sleep their non-REM sleep. So with the EEG, you can see that what they were sleeping, and then you can wake them up when you do not want them to sleep that sleep state. So that is not very nice. So I cannot really explain this experience, but that is true that it is easier to lose the last REM sleep than it's easier than the first non-REM sleep. And the first question was, what was the first question about?
How can you go sleepwalking in the deepest sleep?
That's a good question.
You do naturally make these movements without
you cannot sleepwalk during the REM sleep because you are paralyzed. You can only sleepwalk during the non-REM sleep because then the muscles work. But that is the good question, that why can you do this complex stuff during non-REM sleep? And I cannot give you a complete answer. One point might be that we are actually might not be sleeping with the whole brain at the same time. So there is this thing going on that is called local sleep. So some part of the brain can actually sleep while other parts are awake. And this might be also one of the reasons for these deficits when you are having have not slept enough, is that your some part of your brain decides that, okay, I will sleep now, you guys do your stuff, and then you are just missing something. In animal models, we can see that actually these quite small neuronal populations can sleep without the global brain sleeping. So it might be that this has something to do with these complex behaviors also, that some of your motor cortex, for example, might be quite active, while other parts of your brain, like the frontal cortex that decides what you should be doing, is more deep sleep. But I'm not quite expert on sleepwalking, but I don't know if anyone actually is. Yes.
Okay, I actually have a question. That is, you mentioned that, I don't know if you mentioned it today, but maybe it was during the email exchange when I invited you, that actually there are still a lot of open questions about sleep and why we sleep. And I was wondering, do you have any idea why there is so much that is unknown yet? What are the main difficulties in learning and having new answers related to such important questions like why actually we sleep? Yeah, I mean, why is it so difficult?
It actually is kind of neglected topic, that it has not been thought to be so important for a long time. Psychology itself is not very old subject. You could say that it is only 200 years old. And sleep has been not been a central topic that has been investigated for a long time. So these health benefits of the sleep are kind of in the last decades, there has been a huge surge of these sleep research, that sleep is actually important for this and this and this and this. And this might have motivated now more talking about sleep. But the attitude towards sleep might have been for a long time that it is not very interesting, that nothing really happens, that it is just rest, and that is kind of the trivial answer to everything. And of course, it is a little bit hard to make experiments on this kind of phenomenon, that people are unresponsive and it usually happens during the night, and it is inconvenient and expensive to study sleep in the laboratory, because you have to stay awake while you are doing the experiment with the person who is not wanting to sleep there, because there are better things to do. So I would say that it is a little bit hard to approach, and it has been neglected for a long time.
One more question, if someone has, yes.
Thanks. How much difference between real sleeping and just lay down and close the eyes? So if I have sleep problems, cannot sleep well, but still stay lay down and close the eyes, then it's good for the health. So
I would say that it is, because actually when we look at the EEG of the people, so we are measuring their brains, even at this, well, at stage one, and sometimes even at stage two, when you ask the person that, are you sleeping, the person actually answers you that I am not sleeping. But there is already this electrical activity in the brain has changed. So this very light sleep is also sleep. And I think that if that is all you are going to get, you should take it, that you have the benefits from there. You do not get the full benefits, but you should do at least something. And also there is this form of insomnia, that if you put the person in the EEG and measure their brain, the machine says that they slept quite normally, and the person says that I did not sleep at all. So this is kind of this mismatch between experience of sleeping and this objective measurement of sleeping. So I think it is not quite as simple as this graph makes it seem when we think about the experience, that did you actually sleep. So that is different thing. This is what the machine says, but what the people feel is something different, and probably you will get benefits also from quite light sleep.
Okay, so I think we must leave at least 10 minutes or 15 minutes of time for the final part of the Science Cafe, that is the time in which you can go and ask questions individually to Nils,
and
in whatever language, also in Finnish. No, okay, whatever language, maybe not, but also in Finnish. This was extremely interesting, and I think that there have been a lot of interesting questions and a great discussion. So thank you so much. And well, I will give an announcement in a moment about the next Science Cafe. But before, thank you, Nils.
Thank
Very
you.
Interesting. And the announcement is just, actually there are two. The first one is we have already a date fixed for the next Science Cafe and also a speaker. The date is March, I think, 17th, but the speaker, I will not say it because we have not yet decided the topic. So it will be announced in our Facebook page, Twitter of Science Cafe, and also in the webpage of Science Cafe. So if you follow any of these ways of, you know, if you follow us, you will find information soon, very soon. We hope to have the title soon. But the date is Saturday, March 17th. I think that the 17th is Saturday, so I guess so. So, and here, same place and time from 5 to 7. And well, everyone is now welcome to discuss with Nils, and thank you very, very much for coming. Thanks.
I had a little bit different format than
no,
we usually have.
But it was really nice.
I think it works really because people ask questions.
Yes, exactly. There were so many questions and interruptions all the time, so I think it worked very, very well.
Yes.
I will be around the scene for 10, 15 minutes.
Yes.
And then, but
I can give you the name of the
yes.
Professor Pardo.